Hello, and welcome to Spirit Travels, where we narrate the extraordinary experiences of people who have glimpsed the other side of death. My name is Maureen, and I will be your narrator on this journey. If you enjoy this content, please make sure to like and subscribe to support our channel. Now let's begin. Today's NDE is by Ashley. Ever since I can remember, I had a distinct feeling that I do not belong here and that this place is not my home. I grew up with an abusive father whose violence was unpredictable daily. He also hit my mother and my sister. My parents divorced when I was 12. Part of me was relieved, and the other part of me was sad from huge changes. My older sister went off to college in another state. My mother was very depressed, although she was very good, kind, and supportive of me. I started hanging out with the wrong crowd, and some of my friends were nice and had integrity, and others seemed to violate my trust. I ran away from home when I was 15 years old. I had a very terrifying experience on the streets, like being kidnapped by a psychotic cocaine dealer. I have PTSD that started with my father when I was young. Now, I'd rather be alone, with only a few friends that I can really trust, rather than to try and please others like I did before. In 1989, I felt like I'd been through a personal war with many heartless predators. I was having migraines and headaches every day for months, and I just couldn't take it anymore. I was emotionally destroyed. I felt like my mom was falling apart, and I had no other family for my support system, and I was surrounded by the wrong people who were corrupt and immoral. I went back onto my waterbed and was waiting for all those pills I took with the vodka to start taking effect. There was no particular thought at first, just a feeling. It was a powerful feeling. I was telling my body, "It's time for me to go now." I wanted to go and I was ready to let it all go. Right then, I felt this bizarre large thump in my chest. Then everything started going dark. A few seconds later, I suddenly found myself looking down on my best friend's head and understanding that she was crying, frantic and calling for my mother. My mother ran into the room. Initially, I didn't understand what was happening. I thought it was odd that they were having some kind of panic over someone in my bed, and I didn't understand who was in my bed. Then I looked down closer and saw a familiar face. I was stunned for a moment, realizing, "Oh, that's my body." "Poor thing. Goodbye, old friend," I thought to myself. I feel slightly guilty that I was only a little worried about my mom being sad if I died, but I felt like she'd be okay in about a year. Suddenly, I felt this incredible freedom. It was like a rush of immense joy and liberation. I was no longer limited by my body, and I could just completely be myself. I felt confident, even brave. I was floating upward, but not too fast. I saw everything, but with added colors and added textures and even added feelings. It sounds a little funny, but even the molecules in the wood in the ceiling that I floated through had some type of stagnant energy. I saw the roof of my townhouse complex and the pool. Then I started going a little faster. Suddenly, I was past the clouds and into the stars. I could see the moon, but it had a different kind of hue around it. It was the same moon that I've always cherished, but the glow now showed a purple hue. In fact, I could see purple almost everywhere until I entered the churning blackness. I didn't understand it until later, but I was seeing reflections of other spiritual energy that was like me, but in the universe. I entered into an area that was farther away from the stars and darker, but I was so focused on exploring this whole new feeling of freedom that I wasn't really paying attention. It's almost like I just wandered right in, not even thinking about my safety. It was all new and exciting. I was getting used to my new senses, the new reality, and realizing that I was able to see so much despite not having eyes. This place, darkness that I had gradually entered into was like a giant area of thick blackness that was churning into itself. It had a dull roar type of low hum in the background. It was a substance that was moving very slowly in a predictable direction. I didn't feel like it was good or bad, but rather it was neutral. After a moment, I knew that other beings were coming closer to me. I also knew that they were unfriendly with bad intentions towards me. I suddenly felt very vulnerable, having no idea if I even had any form of protection or power to avoid these negative beings. As they got closer, I felt who they were. I felt their feelings, thoughts, and personalities. I knew that they were never humans, but I didn't understand what they were. They were creatures who started reading my thoughts. I didn't want them to do that because it was scaring me. Then their thoughts and feelings started intruding on my thoughts, and I didn't want that either. I didn't know what was happening or how to stop it. The followers of the lead creature did not have eyes, noses, or a mouth. They didn't have body structures like what you would think of as typical or normal. It was like they were contortions of wretched anguish and misery. The leader was gigantic, with some red and orange colors in it, and about 18 or 20 feet tall. This being was not male or female. It was a monster with no gender. While it did not have a physical body, its energy was like a deeply intelligent being, like a deranged serial killer of the innocent. I could sense its heartlessness and vindictiveness. As they got closer to me, the leader used a strange voice of rage, and it hated me, and I mean really hated me. I asked it bluntly, "Why are you so angry at me? Who are you? I don't understand why you hate me so much." The first thing it said to me was, "Don't you even know who you are?" And I replied, "No, who am I?" The leader seemed to be exploding at this point. It said, "God the Father! You don't even know you're a child of the Father? It's not fair. You should be just as doomed as we are." That's when I started to really have a feeling of terror. I called out immediately, "Jesus, save me! I'm scared! Jesus, where are you? Help me!" I knew instantly that I would be rescued. Then the light of Jesus rapidly moved toward me, and the demons immediately started backing away. I was suddenly pulled out of the churning blackness and into a tunnel of light. It was filled with beautiful, powerful light. I knew I was completely safe and surrounded by love, goodness, wisdom, and authority. Jesus embraced me. He was not in a body, but was a being. A light in the brightest white golden light. It didn't hurt my eyes. The bright white golden light is all about what is good, healthy, kind, and loyal. It is also safety, integrity, trustworthiness, honesty, omniscience, and kingly. When he embraced my soul into his soul, it was like every bit of pain in my spirit was cleansed and healed. But this was only during the embrace. Jesus' spirit was like the equivalent of 500 feet wide and 1,000 feet tall. I instantly knew it was him, and he reassured me and calmed me down. He told me that since I was already there with him, that he was going to show me my life to help me understand about many things so that I'd be more patient when I returned to my body. I refused to go back into my body. He was very patient and gentle with me. He knew I was upset, and he was determined to have me calm down, trust, and listen to him. So I did. I was so indescribably happy and more at peace than ever before in my entire lifetime. I was willing to listen to whatever he wanted to tell me. Where we were, it was like part of heaven, but I didn't see any relatives or anything. This was like a special place reserved for me. I say reserved, like I was in a different section of heaven. During my life review, I felt and saw everything I had ever said or done. I saw every impact I had on others, whether intentional or not, like a ripple on the water. He showed me my very essence, and he explained that different souls have different roles, depending on who they originated from, and what they did with themselves, regardless of the situations. Most important of all was how they responded to love or goodness. Overall, Jesus told me that not only did I have enough goodness in me, but that despite a few weaknesses, that I will mature and that I am destined to go to heaven by virtue of who I am. I asked, "Who am I then? Why is this such a big deal, who I am?" Jesus explained that there are different levels of goodness. Some people have potential for goodness, and they can get into heaven. Some people are basically born with so much goodness already in them that they don't have to try very hard to get into heaven. Then there are those who are descendants of God's original energy, who God is drawing back unto himself. I told Jesus that I didn't understand God and that I was still a little bit mad at God for allowing all the suffering on earth. Jesus told me that it was basically ridiculous of me to be mad at God because that's like being mad at my own arm or leg. He said that we all have spiritual jobs to complete on earth. I told Jesus that whatever my job is, I don't want it and I'm too tired to do it anymore. I feel like Jesus almost laughed, but it was like he was slightly amused and simultaneously worried about me. Jesus and I had an instantaneous communication. Jesus told me that there have been many souls like me around the world whose job it is to be God's witnesses. He said, "That is why I go through so much suffering and experience so much evil. It's not because I'm evil, but because evil wants to destroy anyone and anything that is good. Evil works through people's weaknesses." Jesus showed me part of God's order of the universe, and he said, "That's the one thing I'm not allowed to bring back with me, is that knowledge of how it all works." He explained that the knowledge would interfere with my spiritual growth. The only thing I remember about that part is concluding that it was so complicated that there was no way anyone could understand it in the first place. I finally understood that Jesus was going to send me back into my body, no matter how much I protested. I needed to finish my job in this life for myself and for God. I was a little sad because I didn't want to leave him, and I loved being around him. In 2004, I got to that point again, just like in 1989, when I just couldn't take it anymore. I was in physical pain, felt extreme loneliness, and the people I surrounded myself with were just using me and not being there for me when I needed support or help. I tried to kill myself again. I hoped that I would just never wake up after taking pills. I think my entire system was so overloaded with poison and the intensity of stress that it caused the whole left side of my body to go limp. My arm felt weird and heavy. I think I had a TIA stroke, but I'll never know for sure. I literally felt what seemed like a deep thunder. It was a voice that I felt both in and outside of my head tell me authoritatively that I am with you. You can do this. Do not step out of your place. I started crying and hyperventilating. All I know is right after that, I feel like I left my body for the second time in my life. I recognized going through the ceiling and going through space as I passed the stars. But this time, when I saw that darkness and the distance, I just avoided it. I called out for Jesus again. I saw Jesus as the beautiful, bright, familiar light of love again, but this time, behind him, there was a new presence I had never seen before. The presence filled the entire space or sky around us. It was like a horizon of spirit that was so gargantuan, like Jesus times 20 billion. It was God. God the Father told me in strict terms that I cannot escape my body again, that I will finish my job on earth. This was not just for His glory, but for my own spiritual state. He said that if I ever try to commit suicide again, that He has the power to intervene and send one of His other children to stop me or make any other suicide attempt fail. I was a little scared and very sad and a bit ashamed. I cried out to Him like I have never have before. What can I do? I have no family to help me. I feel so alone. Almighty God then said to me in a booming voice, but in a very loving way without hurting me, "You have not been alone for even one moment in your entire life. I have been there, ready to be with you as soon as you reach for me, as soon as you ask for me. I have also worked through my gift to you of Jesus Christ. I love you and you are my child. I will say it again so you will remember. You are my child and I love you." God showed me something like a movie. He showed me how much I've grown spiritually, even though I may not know it yet. God told me that He's proud of me and that I'm almost finished. He said that if I can just complete my work here, all of my eternity will be filled with the love and peace that I need. I apologized to God and I told Him that I will do my best and that I will try to remind myself that this suffering in this life and in my body will all be forgotten when I'm allowed to stay in heaven. Both God and Jesus reassured me that I will absolutely go to heaven because that is my spiritual destiny. When I'm finished with my spiritual journey and I've completed my work for God, then I will fit perfectly into God's mighty puzzle. Thank you for listening. If you have had an NDE that you would like to share, please email us at travelsinthespirit@gmail.com. Until next time, God bless.